this evening. You can be so many other places, but we are predestined to be right here, right now. I believe the Lord has something for you. Even as you're worshiping, you love on Him. He's here for you right now. How do you know that, Pastor? I've had a tough day because I define my life by the cross, not by my experiences. And when you do that, you'll know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So I just want to encourage you today. Maybe you're going through something. They're going to put a number up there that you can text. And text that number. It'll go directly to my wife. We want to pray for you. If you don't have anything going on, I just encourage you to continue to worship the Lord. Let's create an atmosphere of faith, an atmosphere that the Lord shows up. It says He inhabits the praises of His people. Amen. Let's continue to worship the Lord together.
Y'all believe God's gonna move tonight? Come on. Y'all excited for what God's doing already? It's out of each and every one of your lives. It's amazing.
Than anywhere left in night, you're the Lord.
God, we are so grateful. We are so grateful that you sent us your Spirit, God. God, it's the deposit of things to come. Your Spirit, God. Just like King David said, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Holy Spirit, we love you. We honor you in this place. Move in our heart today, God. For those that are dry right now, God, I pray that you would give them a fresh drink. Refresh their soul in you, Holy Spirit. Let them be able to understand the wooing and the drawing of your Spirit, God.
Jesus!
We thank you for your mercy, God, and your goodness. I ask for more, God. More, more. We thank you for this. In Jesus' name I pray. And the people of God said, just give them a shout of praise. Shake a hand, give an air high five, blow a kiss without the wink, and you may be seated in the name of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah, you got it. Woo! Everybody awake today. Hallelujah. Well, I'm back. Praise God. All right. Three of y'all are excited about that. Praise God. That's great, man. That's great. Thank you. Yeah, so I had a good time while I was in Dallas. And Marlo and Pastor Calvin, Pastor Marlo and Pastor Calvin did an amazing job preaching. Yeah, I was... We don't record Pastor Calvin, so I say that by faith, but he always does good. But I listened to Marlo's, and it was amazing. I was like, man, you even know how to do some alliteration up in that thing. She's preaching good. I love her teaching ministry, because you don't go away not knowing what she said. There's some people, they preach, and you're like, what did they say? That was, y'all awake? Do I need to preach myself happy? I'll do it, man. We just put Papa on hold 2 weeks, and I'll preach, man. So, she did an amazing job. Just her teaching ministry really come alive this last year and a half, 2 years. And so, been awesome. I know she's teaching Papa's notes, so that's probably why. And it's really good stuff, really good stuff. So, can I get the stool over there? You don't need it? Oh, you're good. Okay. No, we're good. We're good. He said he doesn't need it. So, all right. Well, I'm back. Marlo preached. I think I said everything I was supposed to say. And Pastor Doughty is ready to teach. He has this week and next week. Don't bite off more than you can chew yet now. You can preach as long as you can keep going, Paul. So can we just honor the man of God as he comes and preaches for us today?
And that means you had to holler a lot. I remember the first time I got one, it had a string that carried out there, and that kind of limited me a little bit. That was when I got into the tent. So anyhow, you know, I drove down. We got here early tonight, so we just drove around. It's good to see Galveston. But I went down Sportsman Road, and I went all the way to the end, brought back memories of Steamboat Fleming. And I'm going to just tell you a little story for those that know Steamboat. Tommy does and all that. And he used to keep his shrimp boat down there. There used to be a beer joint down there. And he got barned again, but he's one that didn't get sanctified as well as some should. And, you know, he had a little problem with sanctification, getting himself right with God. And so he wouldn't come to church on Sunday morning, but he'd come to church on Sunday night. And I was looking at that piece of property down there, and it you know, the characters that I've led to the Lord, the people, you probably wouldn't hang around them. So anyhow, that's all right. God wanted to save them like he does you. And so consequently, I was looking there, and I remember he came on Sunday night, and he'd bring about five, six drunks in the back of his pickup. And they'd get out, and he said, get inside that church. I'll be in there just a minute. God talked to the pastor. And I said, Steamboat, how do you get them here? He said, well, he said, I give them a choice. He said, you're either going to go to church and get in my pickup and go, but if you don't want to go, then I'm going to beat the hell out of you and put you in my pickup, and you're going to go to church. So now you say, you know, that's not right to say that, church. Well, how many of you know these have been the kind of people? I've led hundreds of them to the Lord, and so it's a great thing. It just brought back a lot of memories. Now, if you have your Bibles tonight, let's get them out. And we've been studying, and we will be studying, and I rested good, and I feel good tonight, and so consequently, we'll cover some good ground. Let's go to Daniel. Take your Bible and turn over to the book of Daniel. Now, I think he'll be able to put it on the screen tonight. But then get your Bible, and then also go to the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 24, Daniel chapter 9, Matthew chapter 24, and we'll be back and forth there. Now, tonight we're going to be studying about the tribulation, and I'm not going to take you over to the book of Revelation to study that. I'm going to bring you up to when the tribulation period of time is. I'm going to show you what the tribulation, what it says about the tribulation, when it begins, those kind of things there. Now, if you really want to do more studying, you go get your Bible, good study Bible, and you study Revelation yourself. It's a whole different study. I don't even want to get into that. So we'll stay in the book of Matthew. We'll stay in the book of Luke. And we might wander around in some Old Testament scriptures in these next couple of two or three lessons that I'll do. And it'll be a blessing to you. Now, one of the things, and go to the book of Daniel, if you will, Daniel chapter 9. And one of the things that you got to be sure, if you don't understand Daniel chapter 9, then you'll never understand end time prophecy. In other words, Daniel chapter 9 is the key to understanding it. In other words, you need to study it, show yourself approved unto God. Now, let's read verse 1 and 2. It says, in the first year, Darius, the son of Azarias, of the seed of Medes, which was made king over the realm of Chaldean, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books the number of years wherewith the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years of desolation in Jerusalem. Now, there's something about 70s and 490 years, 70 years, 490 years, that's very important to God. In other words, these numbers are very important, and they still hold true today. In other words, they still hold true. Now, I want to give you an example. In 1917, there was the Balfour Declaration, and it was at the end of the 1918, actually, when it happened, and it was the end of World War I, and the Turkish Ottoman Empire fell. In other words, it was the fall of the Ottoman Empire, and it began the rule of the British, and there used to be a saying about the British, the sun will never set on the British Isle. And so consequently, the declaration was made and the reestablishment of Israel was established for a homeland for the Jews to come back to. And then they came back and settled back, but after World War II, they really come back and establish it. But it wasn't until 1967 that they gained back to control of Jerusalem. And then they, you know, other wars, they've taken back the whole control of Jerusalem. And so it's amazing now when you study it, 1918 to 1967, you can figure up the years. It's pretty close to that much time. And then you can see, again, time is really important. So years are really important. And what caused them to be in Babylon for 70 years is that they wouldn't let the land rest. That's real important for you. And what happened from the time of Daniel? Now, listen to me very carefully. All the way up to their dispersion into the Babylonian captivity, they backslid. Now, listen to me very carefully. They backslid. They built idols. They worshiped all kinds of sexual perversion. And they killed babies. And that's where we are in America. And they, now, listen, the Bible says, how often do you forgive? Now, I want to go over this, Pastor, so people understand. How often do you forgive? Peter said, 7 times enough for me. And God said, no. Jesus said, 7 times 70. In other words, that's 490 times you have to forgive somebody in one day. Now, think about that. That's a lot of forgiving. Every one of us has been hurt. And so consequently, at any point of that 490 years, had the nation repented, God would have forgave them. Now, do you understand God's forgiveness? Okay, now, that's the same way with America. If we would call a national day of repentance and repent before God, God would forgive us. All right, now, that's one thing I want you to understand. Now, go down to verse number 24. Now, he begins to give Daniel the information he needs to go. No, he said, now 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon the holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end to sin, to make reconciliation for iniquity, bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up the vision and the prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Now he said, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The streets shall be built again, and the walls even in troublous time. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself, and the people of the prince, in other words, he's talking about the Romans that would come, that shall come, shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood unto the ends of war and desolation determined. And in verse 27, he said, and he shall confirm a covenant. This is going to be the last 7 weeks here, verse 27, going to talk about. For 1 week, in the midst of the 1 week of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice, oblation cease, and the overspreading of abomination he shall make desolate even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured out. So these verses give you a breakdown. Now go to my notes now, and let's look here. Now, 1 day represents 1 year. Understand that. And then 1 week represents 7 years. And then 70 weeks equal 490 years. So if you'll just learn that, keep these notes, you'll have an understanding. And he said there'll be 6 things that will be done: to finish transgression, make an end to sin, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up the vision and prophecy, to anoint the most holy. All right, now, then he breaks it down in verse 24, 25, and 26. He said it's going to be broke down like this. He said there'll be 7 weeks or 49 years. There'll be 62 weeks. That'll be 434 years. And that's a total of 69 weeks or 483 years. Now, these notes, if you'll keep them, you can break it down. You can set it by there, read it. You can understand it. Now, if you study, if there was a commandment was given in 454 B.C., in Nehemiah 2, to go back and build the temple and Jerusalem. Now, there was a king named Cyrus, and God had his name mentioned even before he was born. Now, listen to me. I want to say to you that God had your name mentioned before you was even born. God mentioned me in heaven before I was conceived by my father, from my father through my mother, that Robert Dowdy would do what he did. Do you understand? That's how you need to know God knows. He knows the beginning and the end and everything in between. Now, it took 7 weeks from that announcement now, that decree for them to go back. It took 7 weeks or 49 years from the time of the birth of the Messiah, and it took from the time until the birth of Messiah on through to his death would be 62 weeks or 430 years, 34 years. Now, understand, that's the length of time. That's the length of time. Now, if you study civilization, it's only getting close to 6,000 years since the creation. Now, you understand, you understand something. Think about these things. And then, he said, in 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself, but for the Gentiles and the people, the Romans that was there at that time, of the prince shall come, shall destroy the city, Jerusalem, and the sanctuary, and be the temple, and the end thereof shall be with a flood into the end of the war, desolation to determine. And remember now, in Luke 21, is the prophecy fulfilling of the prophecy of Deuteronomy 28, said he would scatter them into all the world. So there's two diasporums. In other words, there's two diasporums that Israel went through, one to Babylon, and it lasted 70 years. the second diaspora, and they both prophesied in Deuteronomy 28. So when you read Deuteronomy 28, the first 14 verses are the blessings. If you'll do this, I'm going to do this. And that's how it works for you and me. God said, if you'll do this, I'll do this. Do you understand that? It's not difficult. I mean, it don't take a scientist to figure that out. Just read it. And then he said, but if you don't, these curses will come upon you. And then it lists the two diaspora, one for 70 years. And you find out also in Jeremiah, there's another place too. And then he said, there'll be another one that I will scatter you into the whole world. Now, I've been to 26 nations, and I can truthfully say I inquire. They're everywhere. Jews are everywhere. And so consequently, he said he would do it, but he said he'd bring them back. But now, when you get through with all of that scattering, all of that that happened, in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, it says this now, and he shall confirm the covenant. Now, it begins to talk about the last week, the tribulation. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. In other words, for 7 years. Now look at me just a minute. For 434 years passed on by till the death of Jesus Christ, and I've used it like this, a stopwatch. It was under Jewish time, the dispensation of the Jews. God reached up there with a stopwatch and went click and left 7 years to be fulfilled. Keep that in mind. Remember prophecy. You study it and it'll fulfill what it says. Then he reached over here. When Jesus was resurrected, he went click and the church age has been taken off. And the church age is made up both Jew and Gentile. Are you understand? Both Jews and Gentiles. Because there was a bunch of Jews that was his disciples. And Luke was a Gentile. You can study. You can find out all these things. Study to show yourself approved. And then that clock has been ticking now for at least 2,000 years, close to it. And it's ticking. But one of these days, the church age will be over. And God said, that'll be enough. And he'll click. And then the rapture will take place. In other words, the rapture is going to take place. And I told you, like a Jewish wedding, Jesus said, in John 14, said, I go and prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you in myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you have to understand, Paul writes a lot about it. We are his bride. Now, when I used to study it when I was young, I said, no, I'm a man. I have a little problem with this. I had to humble myself and realize there's a purpose behind all God's doing. And one of these days, Jesus is going to come with a shout, with the voice of the archangel. In other words, that shout is going to be a shout of victory for you and I. Shout, come on. Let's do this. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout. Clap, come on, clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a voice of praise. Well, you know what? We're going to be the only one who hears that. And we're going to leave out here faster than, they used to use this term, New York minute. I don't guess that's any good. They say a New York minute is faster than any minute on earth. We're going to get out of here. And the believers will leave. They'll be caught up, but the unbelievers will be left on earth. And Pastor, you're not going to be here for that revival. But that will be the greatest revival the earth will ever know. Because they'll start looking for my notes. They'll listen to his sermons. They'll listen to this sermon. They'll listen to these things because they're left behind. And there'll be great revival that takes place. Now, I told you, I like to study the, look up words in the Webster if I have one. In the Webster Dictionary, rapture means the state of experience of being carried away with overwhelming emotions. All right, now, an advent just is a coming. It's arrival. Now, Jesus appears, but only the believers at the rapture are taken. But the unbelievers are left. Now, I believe multitudes are saved right after it takes place. Now, we watch a movie called Rapture. I believe we have that thing called Netflix. and that's what it called. And she got that movie out, and a good Christian. Yeah, huh?
Rapture on Sunday morning.
Rapture on Sunday morning. And it just happened to be a black congregation that was mixed like ours. And the preacher was just preaching it, but then it broke off and it told about families and how they gather on Sunday morning and go to church. There was one father, you know, he wanted to play golf. There was one father that he was so busy about paying bills and griping because he had time. Then there was one woman just fussing and, you know, griping and belly aching about everything. And then they all went to church, and some of them didn't go to church. And then the rapture takes place. And one of them was a minister, theologian. Now, he wasn't a pastor in church. That pastor, man, he was preaching low down. He knew what he was preaching. And he was gone. But there was a whole bunch of them left behind. And then throughout all the news, now remember, there'll be the believers leave and the unbelievers will be left here. Now, somebody's going to be flying that airplane up there. Somebody's going to be driving a car. And there's going to be multitudes. I thought about, I live in an industrial city called Texas City. And I thought about how many maybe of those operators are being lifted out of there, nobody running those units. Now, some of you mouth fell open. There's going to be utter chaos. And they'll be running to this church. They'll be running here to try to find out information. But I want you to know it's going to happen. Maybe morning, maybe noon, maybe night, but it will take place. But the Advent, all eyes will see when he comes. He'll come to the Mount of Olives. Now, I've been to the Dead Sea. I forget the name of the city in the Dead Sea. You remember it, Rusty? In Gedi. And you can look up the valley, and it goes all the way up to Jerusalem, to the Mount of Olives. And that when Jesus comes, he'll plant his feet there. And next week and a couple of weeks to come, I'll be telling you all about that. There'll be a waterway that'll split all the way. And the Mediterranean will flow into the Dead Sea and live again. Are you listening to me? And he'll destroy. Remember when he was baptized by the Holy Ghost. And then the word fire that comes there is not what you've been saying most of the time. He was baptized when he come by Holy Ghost, but he's going to come back and baptize with fire. He's going to come back with fire next time. And all the armies of the Antichrist, the 200 million man army of China that wants to attack one day, come across the Euphrates. Some of you that fought in Iraq, you know where the Euphrates is. I hadn't been that close to it, but I know where it is. And you can see all of the utter chaos that will take place. Now, let's take our Bibles, if you will, and let's go to the book of Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. And basically, I won't bore you with too many more chapters, but let's go there. Matthew chapter 24. All right, now let's look down at verse number 1. Verse number 1. Matthew chapter 24. Now remember, Jesus told us, if you study in the scripture, he said there's three things you need to beware of. The leaven of the Pharisees, the leaven of the Sadducees, and the leaven of the Herodians. Somewhere in all those notes that your wife has of mine, I preached three sermons of the leavens. Now leavens is evil. You understand? It means evil. And he said you have to beware of all of this. Now, the Pharisees was working hard along with the Sadducees, and then the government was working hard to get rid of Jesus. That's how they were doing. They're doing it. Now listen, they're trying to get rid of Christianity around the world. Now you have to understand that. This is not all just something. It's Christianity wants to be done away with because we stand for something different than the world stands for. I hope you do. Okay? And so He comes out and he said, and Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the building of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. In other words, he was giving them some information that was getting ready to happen. Now, from this particular time to about 40 more years down the road, Jerusalem would be completely destroyed, the temple would be destroyed, and the Jewish people would be led away captivity. All right, and then he said, and he sat upon the Mount of Olives, and the disciples came unto him privately, saying three things. Now, they asked him three questions. Tell us, when shall these things be? Question number one. Question number two, and what shall be the sign of thy coming? And question number three, and the end of the world. Now, there's three questions being asked. Now, remember, these were Jewish disciples, Gentile disciples. They had been with Jesus in all the frustration that the Pharisees and the Sadducees were given to Jesus. Now, listen, you think you're going to be buffeted one day. It will get worse one day. You understand? It will. And Jesus faced all that wrath. And he said, now, you have to understand three things you need to understand. And let's look at now on my notes there on page two. It's, first of all, it said, when shall these things be? Now, you can find that in Luke 21 and 12 through 24. I'm not going to read that tonight, but you can go over there and look at it. Now, this is the prophecy fulfillment of Deuteronomy 28, verses 64 to 68. This is what Moses wrote, said, if you don't obey, this is what's going to happen to you. Do you understand? It's a fulfillment of prophecy. Then the second question is, what shall be the sign of thy coming? And you'll find this in Matthew 24, verses 27 through 51. And then what shall be the sign of the end of the Jewish age? Now look at me just a minute. They're living under the Jewish age, the Jewish covenant, and they're asking the question, when will be the end of the Jewish age? That's a good question. And you'll find that in Matthew 24, 9 through 26. So they ask three questions, and he's going to give them the answer to all of those things. And if you'll have an ear to hear and a heart to understand and the fortitude to study and listen and read my notes and study yourself, you won't be taken by surprise. Okay? I mean, everything you see going on in the world is a buildup to all of this. Okay. All right, now let's look down this dispensation breakdown. Let's begin in Matthew 24. Let's begin with verse number 4. Now, he's going to slightly mention the end of the church age here in these verses. Now, it says, and Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no man deceive you. And many shall come in my name, saying, I'm Christ, and shall deceive many. All right, now, look at me just a minute. I think it was in the late 80s. Or the early 90s, excuse me, my dates could be wrong, that every major newspaper, the New York, the Houston Chronicle, every major newspaper, the Dallas, whatever that paper was, every major newspaper in the United States had a picture of some guru, some false prophet, and he took out an ad that he was Christ. I don't know if any of y'all are old enough to remember that. I should have kept the whole thing. I should have it today. But they have been claiming that they're Jesus for a long time. In other words, they're going to be false gods that's going to come and deceive you. Listen to him preach every Sunday. Listen to the Word of God. Listen to me when I preach. Listen to Marlo. Marlo did a good job not speaking anything. He just got a good companion. And the thing that's important is she spoke to the fact that we need to learn to hear the voice of God. And I'll guarantee you it's important that you do. All right, now he said, and you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things which come to pass, but the end's not yet. Now, in my lifetime, there's been a lot of wars, rumors of war. There's been a lot of stuff going on. Now, I read in the paper, I like to keep it, not in the paper. You don't get much out of the paper. But again, we fought in Iraq. And the biggest battle we had, it was in Mosul. And there's not one of you sitting in here know what Mosul is. It's ancient Nineveh. And it's the capital of Assyria. And back a few years ago, ISIS went in and tore down every remembrance of it. And up the news today is that Iraq is beginning now to unite with Iran. Now, all these things are very important. In other words, if you don't keep track of it, you don't know what's going on. Now, I can tell you more, but I just want you to understand. Iraq went to Iran, and they're going to bring together the Persian Empire. Do you understand? That's all the purpose of that. All right, now, let's look at verse 7. It says, nations shall rise against nations. Now, right now, this morning, you saw all the news. We closed down the consulate in Houston, Texas, the Chinese consulate. See, keep track of some of these things. Read in here. All right, now, I was in a country one time where we took our diplomats out of that country, and I was in that country. Now, that's pretty scary. I was with his daddy one time, and we was holding a revival, and they had a revolt in the city. You understand? It's not easy. And living this Christian life, you've lived it easy. All right? And it says nations and kingdoms against kingdom. Now, when you study the word kingdom, that's ethnic group against ethnic group. It'll just be on the rise more and more, everywhere, all the way around the world. And there shall be famines. Okay, now we still have plenty to eat here. I look like it too. And you follow, there'll be famines. But do you understand, if you just go and go on your paper and watch the stock market and watch the futures of what's going on with corn, cattle, hogs, this kind of stuff, you'll begin to see there's a lot of changes being made. And then there'll be pestilence. What do you think we're under right now? It's pestilence. All right, now, and then it says, and earthquakes in divers places, there are probably not 10 or 15 of you even realize today, there was a 7.8 earthquake off the coast of Alaska, the Aleutian Islands today. Now, that's big. That's what you call big. All right, now, all these things are the beginning of sorrows. In other words, it's the beginning of birth pains. Now, I'm a father. And my wife and I gave birth to two children. And I'll guarantee you, just prior to birth, them women can tell you those birth pains. They'll come along in that eighth and ninth month, you know, you'll hear them talking. But as it gets maybe a week or two out, you can hear them talking. And then one night they'll say, get up. Because those birth pains are really after it. Now, you follow what I'm talking about. I'm not out of the way of saying all this. I'm a father. I fathered a couple of children. And so consequently, you hurry. You either get a midwife there or you get a doctor. You get them to the doctor, whatever. And those birth pains, Jesus says as we get closer, the birth pains will get closer and closer. And so all these things will be taking place. All right, now, let's go down beginning in, let's see here. Let me find my place again. Let's go down in verse number 9. Now, this is going to speak of some of the first half of it, all right, beginning in verse 9. And they, then shall they deliver you up. Now, I want you to look at this. This is not you. They're not delivering you up. This is the disciples. This is the people that's living now. And Jesus said, now, there's going to come a time they're going to deliver you up. And you're going to be persecuted, you Jews. And it says, deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. In other words, the most hated group of people in the world today are the Jews. Let's just face it. That's the most hated group. Hitler hated them. Stalin hated them. You follow what I'm talking about? They're the most hated group. And Jesus said, I'm going to warn you. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another. That's believers and unbelievers. See, we have believers in this church tonight, and there could be an unbeliever here. they'll start betraying each other. And many false prophets shall rise and deceive many. It's just like on two different occasions. One occasion, it was a full-page ad in the major newspaper of a person declaring themselves out of the Far East as being Christ. Now, it's in our time that we're living, it's going to get worse. These things will come up, and you need to be wise. He used to tell me, his father did, he said, "Daddy, you got to be smarter than you think you are. No, you got to be smarter than the thing you're doing." That's what he used to say, wasn't it? "And because iniquity," now iniquity is called lawlessness. Now, lawlessness, we're seeing it in our country now. We're seeing lawlessness. You know, Chicago, Minnesota, Seattle, we're seeing that. But now, you go overseas, it's just as bad over there. We're just hearing about our time. "And iniquity shall abound, and the love of many shall wax cold." Now, do we say this is going to get better? Well, probably not. To some degree, it can slow down again. It can pick up. It can slow down. It can pick up. But these things will begin to get worse. Now, you have to understand, it's just how it is. Are you following me now? And this is not to put fear into you. This is to build faith. Now, I've already said up here, what if they arrest you for preaching the gospel? So be it. Are you listening to me? What if they arrest you? You know, it might not be too long where they just open up prisons. They're doing it overseas. Now, you follow what I'm talking about. Now, you say, "Pastor, that scares me." Well, I can't help it. Just get scared and get over it and realize by faith is how you live. But he that shall endure to the end shall be saved. Now, that endure is to stay with it to the end. In other words, do not cow down. Just don't take cow down. Now, Pastor, you know how old I am. I might have to go on home first, but you cannot allow yourself to cow down. You're going to have to stand. But now let me say this to you. All of you out there, you expect him to do more, but God expects all of us to do the same thing. Are you listening to me? And then it says, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached into all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come." Now, listen to me. I've done a lot of missionary work. I've been to countries without visas. I've been to Uzbekistan. That they didn't have a flight in but every 7 days. I got there without a visa. I was detained by the government, but God told me to go there. I've been to places you wouldn't even dare even think about going. When we was in Uzbekistan, we were there for one family. I was in the marketplace, and a guy hit me real hard. And they all had daggers on their legs, knives. They all had gold teeth. I thought when they died, I wanted to take their teeth out for the gold. And Larry, I was with Larry Garza, if you ever been to know him. And he said, "Don't hit him back, Pastor." I said, "I'm not. He's big. Boo." But you know what? When they found out and they watched it, there was a little 14, 15-year-old boy that was learning to speak English. Now, you have to understand, after World War II, English became the language of the world. English became the language of prosperity. Do you understand that? And so they knew prosperity existed in our countries. And he said, "Would you teach me English?" And we said, "Sure." And then he invited us to his brother's house. And his brother's house, they met us as all Muslims. And the one thing you have to understand about Muslim people, they're good Muslims, okay? And if they'll invite you to break bread with them, they'll be at peace with you. I broke bread downtown at this one here. You understand? I've been to the end of their Ramadan. I took her, I think, one time with me. You understand? You have to be smarter than the thing you're doing. Don't fuss about some things. Listen and get an inroad. And we went in there, and he had fought over in Cuba, or he'd been stationed in Cuba with the Russian army. And he got inquisitive. And he said, would you break bread with us tonight? That's at 6 o'clock when they broke fast. And they killed the lamb about 9 or 10 o'clock at night, and they had us over there. And they cut the heart out. And they served it with a few little vegetables. And I tell you, I never chewed the bottom. I cut that heart, and I chewed that thing. I had all of my teeth in. I chewed it on this side. I chewed it on that side. I chewed it on that side. I had the wine, and I drank a little of wine. It took me forever to get it down. And then we asked them to come to the hotel. And when we went to the hotel, we made a breaking of fast at the hotel. And there was a Russian group of soldiers followed us everywhere we went. And we broke bread with them. And then we took a video of the life of Jesus Christ in the Uzbek language. And we gave it to them. Larry told me, he said, stay in there, because if they arrest me, at least you'll be in there. They'll have done for you, I'm sure. Are you listening to me? And we left it, and they watched it before we left. And we said, what do you think? Very interesting. Now, how many of you know, if God will take a person like me and Larry Garza and send us to Burma, send us to Thailand, send us to Singapore, send us across the Himalayas to Uzbek to give one person the gospel, our family. How much do you think he cares for you? Now, I'll probably see him up in heaven. I'm sure when we get to heaven, they'll come over and say, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. That's what it's about. That's what this stuff is about. Let's see. Hallelujah. Amen. I stayed in a place. I'm going to end with a couple testimonies. I flew in overseas to Singapore. And you know, after World War II, we didn't send missionaries to Japan. When we fought the Korean War, we sent missionaries. And the Presbyterians were the largest group that went. And I went to Singapore, and there was a hotel built back in the 50s, a whole hotel built by Christians for people like Larry and I as we passed through Singapore to go into other places in the world. That was free of charge for us to stay. And I sat down with an old man like I am today. And I said, how did you get here? What is your life about? He said, when I was young, after World War II that I fought in, he said, I got on a ship and I told God, I'm going to go for the people I had to kill. And the people I had to fight in Singapore, different places around the world, I'm going to go give them the gospel. And he got on that ship, and it sailed. And it began to have mechanical problems. Now, this is the true story. And he said we was close to one of the islands. And he said we went over there. We was kind of in distress, didn't know what to do. And listen, I don't care where you go, God will make the next arrangements, even if it seems to be no. And he said, Pastor, we went ashore, and we found a ship just exactly like ours. And we got aboard that ship, and we found the part. And we put that part on, and we said, God, send us to Singapore. And there they built that mission for people like me to go into the world. I've been in Burma, right at China. A communist dictatorship, a Marxist government, where they had people all in your congregation when we preached. You didn't say anything out of the way. I was there in probably at least 10 or 15 degrees, cold weather. Slept in everything I could sleep in. No heat, no warm water. And my transportation was a bicycle. And there we preached the gospel and people got saved. Now listen, you either going to go or you're going to send. You're either going to tell people about the gospel. Listen, I could tell you 15 or 20 more stories. Easily. But God wants you to take this simple gospel. He wants you not to have the message that I'm preaching to you tonight to put fear into you, but to put faith into you. Amen. And there could be some of you tonight that you've never gave your heart to Christ. Now, don't anybody tell me about going to the world. I've been there. I was on an airplane that landed in the country one time, and they come on with AK-47s. We landed, and there was a bunch of just white guys from America and Britain. And I've had AK pointed that far from my nose. They went up just like this with that gun and just pointed at me. I sat there, I said, oh, God, please don't let them shoot me or take me off the plane. I've been down in a medical missionary work in Sri Lanka. We had $100,000 worth of pharmaceutical, and the leading infectious doctor from Bader College of Medicine, Dr. Todd Price, was with us. And that's where I learned this statement: if you can't talk faith, shut up. Because if you can't talk faith, you might die. And when we went down there, Pastor, listen, when we went down there to get the gospel, we had to go through 21 checkpoints. And I was a key man to roll the window down. I don't know why they gave me that job. And that Hindu driver, he was scared because every time we was driving down there and where there would be a little deal to worship, you worship everything, they stop and he'd worship. But finally, when we got to, I had guns pointed at me a lot. When we and I'm not saying this to brag on myself. When we got there, they put us in a barracks, and they began to fight mortar fire, small artillery, and they fought all night. Now, you lay in a bed, you don't get any sleep. But you know what we did? The next morning, the Hindu driver said, would you tell us about your Jesus? We went down to the first mission. The Hindus were the first one. They had examined them, give them medicine, and either I or another Christian, two or three Christian preachers, we'd tell them about Jesus. I can't tell you how many people were saved. We did it for the Muslims. How many know when you're sick, you want help? Amen. Now, Pastor, come give an invitation. Let's see if people will be saved.
Hallelujah. You know, we don't want to close this service without giving you an opportunity to know him. You do not have to walk in fear. He is for you. He's not against you. And it's trusting in the cross that can change your whole life. We are going towards the end times. My question is, are you going to have the Savior in your boat? Or are you going to try to do the storm by yourself? So if that's you today and you say, you know what, I want to accept Jesus, maybe a first time, maybe you want to rededicate tonight. If that's you today, just lift your hand high in the air. I want to pray with you today. If you're on Facebook right now, if you can just put pray for me in the comments. Anybody here, you want today to be a day of new beginnings for you? Amen, I see that hand. Anybody else? I see that hand as well. Anybody else? Father, you see those hands that were lifted up towards you, God. God, we just ask that you would forgive us of our sins. Wash us clean. Jesus, we believe you died on the cross and rose again. And you're seated at the right hand of the Father. And God, you're more than a God. You're our Father. Teach us, guide us. Holy Spirit, fill us right now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you prayed that simple prayer with me, you're brand new in the kingdom of God. Old things have passed away. All things are new. I want to give you two words today. Welcome home. Welcome home. You're in the family of God with us together.